Hi y'all, it's Curious Raven. This time I'm gonna do something a little different than a true crime. These are more of mystery of people going missing, and it's little short stories. They're true stories, but short stories. I hope you like this. I wanna see how this does. Don't worry for the true crime people out there. I will be doing true crime. It's gonna be kind of a mixture of one Friday I might do a true crime one, another Friday I might do unsolved mysteries, things like that, or just weird stuff that happens. Well, I'm gonna start. Matus Kawicki. In 2018, a 30-year-old Polish man goes missing on the way to the hospital where his wife is giving birth. 5 months later, after complaining about the stench, neighbors find his body in his parents' barn, 400 miles from where he was supposed to be. In the barn, there were two nooses, some mysterious items, and a backpack, and his car is missing. There are a lot of unanswered questions. Yeah, I don't know how someone overlooked this guy hanging from your barn for 5 months. Does his family not go into their barn? Was it a dilapidated barn? Was it a barn far, far away and they didn't, the neighbor smelled it, so they don't know how he got there. They don't know what happened, who killed him. Was it actual suicide? Why? But these are all unanswered questions. They have no clue. Bennington Triangle. The Bennington Triangle disappearance are both creepy and mind-boggling. During a 5-year period, 1945 through 1950, five individuals, male and female, ranging in age from 8 years old to 70 plus, vanished under mysterious circumstances. So, I guess there is kind of this area in this town that roads connect in this little triangle in this town, and five people went missing in that little triangle, like the Bermuda Triangle, but it's actually on land and it's in a town, and they don't know what happened to them. Their bodies were never found, no leads, nothing. So that's just really weird to me. Sabrina Asenberg and Haley Cummings. Baby Sabrina just basically vanished into thin air. I know a lot of people think the parents killed her, but I think Sabrina is out there alive somewhere. As for Haley, it seems obvious Dad's girlfriend had something to do with the little girl's disappearance, but I still can't believe she was smart enough to fool the police. Where are these girls? It's so bizarre. I hope someday the truth comes out. The murder of Beth Bernard and the disappearance of Vivian Cameron. It doesn't matter what angle you look at this case from, it simply doesn't make sense. Popular consensus is that after murdering Beth, Vivian killed herself by jumping off a bridge where her car was found. But her best friend got a call from Vivian the following morning to talk about knitting, which was corroborated by another friend who was also there. There's also a bunch of other problems with this theory. Case File True Crime Podcasts do an amazing episode on it, which I highly recommend. I've read books on this case, and it's still just as mysterious as to who murdered Beth and what happened to Vivian. Asia Degree. Apparently, for no reason anyone can think of, a 9-year-old girl gets up and starts walking down a highway during a rainstorm with no shoes on in February in western North Carolina, and then just disappears off the face of the earth. The FBI found her book bag buried inside a plastic bag at a construction site. Almost certainly somebody else was involved in her disappearance, but there's no proof that anyone else was in that house. She was seen by two witnesses alone, walking down the highway. She did not have access to the internet in her home. No chance she was trying to meet an internet stranger, and the FBI has never suspected the parents. I honestly think the real story has never been told to the public. And the FBI is looking for some random green car. Nobody knows why. Now that's just sad. This little girl is so adorable, and it breaks my heart that no one saw nothing, and that was it. Amy Lynn Bradley. If she really fell off the ship, it would have been terrible. But if they had at least found her body, her family would have had closure. Not knowing what happened all these years later is mind-boggling. as any of the most popular 2 to 3 theories of what happened to her are possible. This one is about the young girl that they saw. She worked at the cruise ship and they have her on camera acting normal, doing normal things, and then just bam, all of a sudden, supposedly, she just disappeared and people think that she went overboard. But we, you know, I don't know. That's just Mara Murray. She seems to have been wrestling the usual demons and ran away from her life. She certainly was not being stalked or harassed, just drove away from her life. The exact circumstances at the end are murky at best, but she seems to have the actor. A sad situation that causes her father to end his grief. Foul play could have played a part, but no actual evidence to that end. David Dwayne Bell. David disappeared for Owensboro, Kentucky in 1986. Was he a killer or a victim of convicted killer John Rainier? What does his disappearance have to do with Shannon Green's disappearance and Angie Dickinson's murder? There is an audio tape of Dwayne saying he killed the girls and his father helped. Police had the tape in their possession for over 20 plus years and said they lost it. In 2005, the tape magically reappeared. Very strange and fishy. Ben McDaniel. He was a self-taught diver who went diving in Ponce de Leon, Florida, in a treacherous cave that literally had a sign saying, "There's nothing in here worth dying for." To even get into the cave, he had to be a certified cave diver. This cave had a locked gate. You had to show proof of your certification in order to get a key for the gate to go in. The witness who saw him go in the cave, a park employee, later admitted that he let him into the cave due to the fact that he'd snuck his way in numerous times before. So, he figured there was no harm in just letting him go through, seeing as he'd sneak in anyways. He never returned from the cave, and his remains have never been found, despite extensive searching. His vehicle never left the parking lot he'd parked it in. Multiple of the world's best cave divers aided in the search, but nothing was found. They sent a camera in the cave, but the cave eventually became so narrow that the camera could go no further. There was also extensive searching through the slit within the cave. Some of his belongings were found, his diving equipment, but his remains have never been found. Lindsay Buzak. Lindsay is a young real estate agent showing a house to someone that she felt used a fake accent and somehow had her personal phone number. She was uncomfortable enough to ask her boyfriend to meet her at the showing, and he did, but he showed up too late and waited outside. He could see that the showing was still in progress. She never came out. Text to her phone went unanswered, and she was found murdered in an upstairs bedroom. The front door was locked, and the suspects, a man and a woman, apparently fled out a back door while her boyfriend waited for outside. This one bothers me because I feel like she did everything right. Monica and Michael Bennett. I learned about this case from a podcast called The Fall Line, which is an in-depth investigation of each case they cover, including family interviews. I'm amazed how many teenagers were running away in the 1970s, according to the police. Brian Schaefer. He went out with his friends to a bar. He's been arriving with friends. All exits had security cameras. He's seen hanging out, an hour later chatting with some girls. He goes back in and that's it. His friends say they got separated from him, but get this, no camera saw him leaving. Najah Farrell. Last year, a woman named Najah Farrell went missing from my town. They found her car about half an hour from here at a movie theater and then just her foot in a pond off a highway 65. She lived the next block over from me. I was always curious what happened to her, but the cops never released any more information. Now, this little collection was actually by an author named Emily Madriga. She wrote these August 12th, 2020, and it is from the internet site Thought Catalog. Some of these I've heard of myself, but a lot of them I'm kind of curious. I would like to dig in and see what else is going on. Virginia Dare. On August 18, 1587, Virginia Dare was born in Roanoke Colony, making her the first English child born in the Americas. Her grandfather was John White, who early that year had helped found Roanoke. But White never saw Virginia grow up because by the time he returned to Roanoke from an extended trip to retrieve supplies, the entire colony had vanished. Not just the people, but even the structures. No one knows what happened to Virginia or the rest of the Roanoke colonists. Owen Parfitt. The disappearance of old Owen Parfitt from his sister's front porch in the English countryside isn't nearly as famous as the disappearance of Amelia Earhart in 1937. But it's even more mysterious. In the summer of 1763, or thereabouts, accounts offer on the exact year, while living with his sister in the town of Shepton Mallet, the paralyzed 60-year-old Parfitt simply disappeared. He couldn't have walked away, but even the farm workers in the field across the road from the park where Parfitt was sitting didn't see anyone come or go. One moment he was there, the next, poof, gone. Ambrose Bryce. The stories of American author Ambrose Bryce were part of the inspiration behind the first seasons of HBO's True Detective. Bryce himself is the subject of a real-life mystery that will likely never be solved. One day in 1913, when Bryce was in his 70s, he told his friends and family he was going to Mexico to join Pancho Villa's revolution. After sending a few letters from Mexico, Bryce was never seen or heard from again. Some speculate he was killed in action, while others believe that he may have committed suicide. Barbara Newhall Follett. Finishing her first novel at age 8, Barbara Newhall Follett had written 4 books by the time she turned 18, but her literary success came at a price. She never had a childhood. By age 25, Follett had fallen into depression, and on the evening of December 7th, 1939, she walked out of her house after an argument with her husband, never to be seen or heard from again. Her body was never found. Well, I think she just ran away. That's what I think. But that's just my opinion. And sorry if I did not say her last name right. I do struggle with names. Alright. Paula Jean Weldon. Paula Jean Weldon was a sophomore at Bennington College on the day in December 1946 that she disappeared without a trace after telling her roommate she was taking a long walk. At one point, Paula's father was suspected in her disappearance. He was later cleared. Over the next 10 years, a local Bennington man bragged to friends that he knew where Paula's body was buried, but he couldn't lead police to the gravesite. No one knows what really happened to Paula, but her disappearance ranks as one of history's strangest unsolved mysteries. James Tetford. Strangely enough, Bennington was the site of several unsolved disappearances that took place in the 1940s. Remember, I talked earlier about the Bennington Triangle. These are the victims, including that of the wife of James Tetford, whom Tetford claimed went to the market and never returned. Just a few years later, in 1949, Tetford himself disappeared without a trace. He was last seen on a crowded bus, sleeping in his seat. Yet when the bus reached Bennington, Tetford had gone, all of his belongings left behind. He was never seen or heard from again. That is so creepy. The MV Joyita. On October 3rd, 1955, the merchant vessel MV Joyita departed Samoa from the Takalua Islands. I'm sorry if I'm butchering that. A month later, she was found drifting in the South Pacific, 600 miles off of her course. All her passengers, crew, and cargo were gone. Some believe the ship was a victim of piracy. Another theory as it the boat was taking on water. It was listing when it was discovered, and the 25 people on board abandoned ship prematurely and were lost. That sounds really fishy. Maybe it's like one of those weird conspiracies and they're just poof, they disappeared or they ate each other. I don't know. I need to stop. Okay, Patty Blue, Ranelle Burrell, and Ann Miller. On July 2nd, 1966, 3 young women in bathing suits were seen happily boarding a small motorboat at Lake Michigan Beach. Crime reporter Dick Wiley, who dove deeply into the women's backstories, believed they had taken the boat to visit a floating abortion clinic, one which reformed backroom abortions. This was 7 years before Roe v. Wade. I believe something went wrong with one of the procedures, Wiley told the New York Daily News. The abortionist must have lost one girl, and they did away with the other two because they couldn't leave witnesses. Oh, that is horrible. That is so horrible. The Sarah Jo. In February 1979, five friends departed the coast of Maui for a fun day of fishing on a small boat called the Sarah Jo and motored into one of Hawaii's worst storms on record. When they failed to return, a massive search was conducted to no avail. Sad, but not that surprising when it comes to maritime tragedy. Then things got weird. A decade later, the Sarah Jo was found wrecked on the coast of one of the Marshall Islands, next to the grave of what turned out to be one of the five men. How did he get there? Who buried him? And where is that person now who could explain this mystery? We'll never know. I think I've heard of that story, and it's... they could watch a movie or some documentary about that recently, and they don't know where the other people are. And it was funny because they were found, and they said, oh no, we're fine. We can just, you know, we'll get back to land because it got off course. And then the storm hit, and then they never saw everybody again. And then this guy turns up being buried on an island. Well, who buried him? Where are they? It's just real weird. No one in their families never heard from these men, four men again. Maybe Reinhard? Keith Reinhard. This mystery starts with another man, Tom Young, who one day in 1987 took his dog for a walk near Silver Plum, Colorado, and never returned. Young had been renting rental space in town, which was then rented to Keith Reinhard. The new tenant found Young's story so intriguing that he began writing a novel in which the main character was a composite of both Young and Reinhard. In 1988, a week after Young's body was found by hunters with a shot to the head, presumed suicide, Reinhard went for a hike and never returned. Coincidence? Conspiracy? No one knows. Jody, I'm sorry about her last name. Huizentrout was an Iowa news anchor who disappeared from the parking lot of her apartment complex on June 27th, 1955, at 4:10 a.m. She was headed into work. There were signs of a struggle, and some of her belongings were found strewn beside her car, including two shoes, two earrings, and her car key. Although a partial palm print and a hair were recovered from the scene, Jody's fate remains unknown. That has, like, someone took her, written all over it. Ray Grycar. On April 15, 2005, Ray Grycar, a homicide prosecutor for Center County, Pennsylvania, told his girlfriend he was skipping work that day for a drive to Lewisburg, about 50 miles from his home, where he was hoping to enjoy a day of shopping and strolling. The next day, his car was found by a state trooper in a Lewisburg parking lot. His laptop was found 6 months later under a bridge. It was missing its hard drive. The hard drive was found several months later, too damaged to be read. Beyond that, no trace of Grycar was ever found. He was declared dead in 2011. Well, he was a homicide prosecutor, so I'm guessing a murderer probably took him and wanted to erase any evidence that he had. Maybe he got too close to turning the person in or prosecuting them or whatever, but someone was pissed. That's what I think. Barbara Bullock. On July 18th, 2007, 55-year-old Barbara Bullock went for a hike with a family friend in the Bitterroot Mountains of Montana. According to the friend, Jim Remaker, he and Barbara, a physically fit and experienced hiker, headed to an overlook where they stopped for a snack. Barbara walked back down the trail as Jim took one last look at the view, and then she vanished without a trace. More than a decade later, Barbara's disappearance remains unsolved. I think that other man had something to do with it. That's just me. Lauren Spierer. On June 3rd, 2011, 20-year-old Indiana University student Lauren Spierer disappeared after a night of partying with her friends. People recently reported, despite possible leads that included the arrest and conviction of a man for killing another Indiana U student in 2015, Bloomington police still have no updates on Spierer. Lauren's disappearance has been and continues to be the most heart-wrenching experience of our lives, her parents write on their Facebook page. 7 years later, we continue to search for Lauren, for truth, for justice. All of these little short stories I just read were by Lauren Kahn. She published them March 20th, 2020 on Reader's Digest. I just read stories that other people wrote. It's on the internet for the public to see, and I wanted to give their references out because I do not want to get in trouble. I want to be respectful. You know, there are a lot of narrators that don't do that. So every story you hear, I always ask them, especially not these because they're kind of like a public article, but I try the ones that are from Reddit, the true crime I usually get from the internet. I just do a lot of research. This, I did some research, and the true crime and the paranormal, I always ask for permission. Always just have to be respectful. So if you're a person that is trying to go into being a narrator, do not forget that, because it is, you can get in trouble, like legally in trouble, if you do not ask permission. And they have to say, yes, you can read my story, because there are some people that their story gets so much publicity and so many likes on social media that they want you to pay. They want you to pay for their story to be read. I'm just, you know, lucky, and I ask nice, and it's for real people that have real heart-wrenching, horrible things that happen to them. And sometimes it bothers me. It bothers my conscience. And I always try to tell, you know, when I write down in my description that thank you for letting us tell other people about your stories. It's helpful. It really is, because there are a lot of stalker stories and kidnapper stories that I read about, that people almost get kidnapped and stuff, and people can learn from what you do that you might be able to do in a situation. And then you do learn from people's mistakes, and you know what not to do. So I feel like sharing stories about experiences will help others learn more and help protect themselves. So I will just say this, that this is a depressing time in our USA, and I want everyone just to please stay safe, keep your family safe, be prepared for anything, but you just gotta have faith and wear masks. I want to make sure I keep others safe just in case. Like my stepdaughter, she has COVID this week. She was complaining of a headache, and I felt bad because I was like, oh, you're just trying to get out of school, and I had to go and get her from school because she was dizzy and had a headache, and I feel so bad now because I thought that she was just trying to play hooky, but she got tested and she has COVID, and my whole family has been quarantined for almost 2 weeks. You know, the election and everything had me stressed to the max, and instead, I did a live stream and let y'all just replay a lot of my videos because I wasn't in the state to give you my best. But today I'm feeling a lot more better, and I want to tell everybody I love y'all so much. I am very happy to have all of you as my subscribers, especially some of my OGs that's been with me, you know, from the beginning, actually. And hopefully they'll be with me until I get real big, and I want to keep doing this. I want to be able to help my family and be actually, you know, contribute. And I really love doing this, and I just love being here. And it makes me happy to know that some people fall asleep to my voice. It's funny because my husband, he actually gave me the idea again to maybe start doing narration, because sometimes he can't sleep and he'll tell me just to start talking about random like childhood stories and he just goes straight to sleep. He says my voice is really soothing to him. First, when I used to work fast food when I was a teenager, I had this older couple, and they're like, you have such a good voice in drive-thru. You should do narration for kids' stories. And that's always been in the back of my mind, and that's what got me started. I've been doing this, I would say, probably about a year. I actually don't even remember when I started my channel. It's been about a year. It was when COVID started, and I was like, hey, why not? I'm home. I'm not working. I mean, I am. I'm a mom of three, and I do go to school, and trying to get another degree, even though I probably won't use it. But hey, is an achievement. Keeps me busy. I also do this, and I actually have like a little business on the side. So I try to keep busy. But one day I would love to be able to do a live stream with you guys. But I don't really think that y'all would think that I'm interesting. I don't really have a really interesting life. So I don't know. Just let me know what y'all think. If y'all would be ever interested. I kind of wanted to wait until I had more subscribers. Alright, well that's it for this Friday's video. I love y'all. I will see y'all next week with probably some more true Reddit stories and experiences. Remember, please go like and subscribe to my channel. I have Instagram, Facebook. I actually have a TikTok. I just posted on it. It is just called Curious Raven. That's it, at Curious Raven. You can go check it out. I do little short stories on it. I only got like two up, but I'm building. So you can go check that out and subscribe to me. Remember, I do have Patreon. You can go help me support the channel and me and doing videos and helping me out. And you do get really cool incentives. Also, I do have my merch store. Jensen on his live stream, he actually showed my shirt. And told everybody to go subscribe. So y'all should subscribe to Jensen. He is amazing. Also, Let's Read is amazing. As the Raven Dreams is amazing as well. I mean, I have so many narrators I love and are friends with. We just are an awesome community. And I'm really happy y'all are a part of this family. Alright, I will talk to y'all later. But until then, remember, it's scary out there.